Come on, let's sing. is here. God is here. God is in our midst. His presence is in our midst. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise you. Come on, let's give him the best cup offering that we can give. He deserves all the praises. You are here, oh God. You are in this place, Lord. Let's continue to worship him. Let's continue to revel in his presence. This song says, we need a fresh wind. Who among us here need a revival from the Lord? No, who needs to be refreshed? All we need to do is just tap into God's presence. Because in his presence there is peace. Because in his presence there is freedom. There's joy. Are you feeling blue? God's presence, his mere presence, is a presence of joy. So let's just come to him and seek his presence.
Oh Lord, we need your presence, Lord.
We need your fresh wind, oh God. We need a fresh wind from you. Spirit come, Spirit come.
Spirit sound, rushing wind, fire of God, fall within. Holy Ghost, breathe on us, we pray. As we repent, turn from sin, revival embers smoldering, breath of God, fan us into flame. We need a fresh wind, the fragrance of heaven. Pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out. Oh,
pour your spirit out, oh God. Holy Spirit, fill us up, fill our hearts.
Oh Lord, as we repent, turn from sin, revival embers smoldering, breath of God, fan us into flame.
We need a fresh wind.
We need a fresh wind. The fragrance of heaven. Pour your spirit out.
Pour your spirit out.
Pour your spirit out. A holy anointing. The power.
Prophesy
and sing. We can
Spirit's blowing, move upon our praise. Yes, Lord. Sons and daughters sing. We can hear the wind blowing. It's blowing, blowing. We need a fresh wind. The fragrance of heaven. Pour your Spirit out. Yes, Lord. Pour your Spirit out. Let's cry out, Lord. We need a fresh wind. We need a fresh wind. The fragrance of heaven. Pour your Spirit out. Yes, Lord. Pour your Spirit out. Holy anointing. The power of your presence. Pour your Spirit out. Pour Jesus, for death could not hold you, the veil's all before you, you silenced the noise of sin and grave, the heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised, hallelujah.
You have no rival.
Yes, Lord.
Now and forever.
name above all names. We exalt you, Lord. Your name is exalted. The name above all names. Jesus. Jesus. We praise you. And in every home right now, let's continue to press in. Let's just continue to press in into His presence. Hallelujah. Sige po, let's just continue to come. Let's just continue to declare who Jesus is over our life. His name is above every name. There is no rival in His name. Hallelujah. Oh, we press in, we press in, we press in, Lord. We declare who you are in every situation of our life. Lord, we thank you that you are a God who cares for every one of us, who personally knows all of our needs. And you are a God who is with us, caring for us, ready to help in times of our needs, oh God. Lord, I continue to declare your name that brings healing for everyone who are sick right now. For every individual, family members that we have, Lord God, who are sick, Lord, we thank you for the healing that we have in you. Lord, we thank you for the freedom that we have in you, Lord God, to worship you, Lord, today. Thank you for the peace, Lord God, that will continue to reign over in this room, Panginoon, and in every household, Lord God, that is watching right now. Thank you for your presence that is near, that is here, Lord. Lord, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you for the victory that we have in you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Can we just give God the best clap of praise today? Hallelujah, that He deserves. You know, our God is a victorious God. We just receive a lot of praise report from people over the week. One of our young people who are anxious for the past week just texted me that he thanked God because he experienced the peace of the Lord while worshiping just this early morning. And he experienced freedom from this fear over his heart. We also thank God for the healing of Tita Grace Clavicillas. Maybe you know her for so long. And for the last month, we've been praying for her because she will undergo a blood transfusion. It's hard because there's a lot of blood already in her body that is blocking her. But right now, he really thanked God. I just called her last day that she really thanked God because she already finished the blood transfusion. And she is so, I really praise God because I heard her praising God for what he has done and all of your prayers. That is our amazing God. And also a friend from Canada who received I receive a praise report from her, Kuya Henry Raya, a friend who is positive from COVID, but right now he is now negative and there is no contamination over the company. Praise God! There's a lot of good things that our victorious Jesus can do over our life. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? If you believe that, whatever your situation right now, maybe this is financial need, relationship that you are worrying right now, or maybe this is a sickness in body, a relative, we're sick right now. Can we just call in the name of Jesus right now? Let's just declare who He is over our life. I just want to give you time right now to close your eyes and just declare Jesus over your life. He's the name above every name. There's no rival in His name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you for the freedom, Lord God, that we can come to you right now. Lord, we thank you that you know all the needs of these people, Lord God, who is raising their hands. And we thank you that you care for them. You will give them a heart that brings forgiveness, Panginoon, for those who are people, Lord God, that hurt them. Lord, thank you for the provision for this family who is watching right now, who is in need of new job opening, Lord. Thank you for opening the door right now. And a good news will come. A good news coming from you, an answered prayer, Lord God, for this family. Thank you for a miracle of healing, Lord God, for this man, for this woman, Lord God, for a long time been praying and pressing in. Lord, I pray that your healing will flow right now. Move in power, Spirit of God. And Lord, we thank you for the faith that is rising right now for everyone who is watching right now, Lord God, who needs faith, Panginoon, to come rise, Lord God, in their situation. We thank you that you are here, you are with us, you are powerful, and we can call into your name, Jesus. We praise you. In your name we pray. Amen and amen. Can you give again the best clap of praise to Jesus? Come on, come on, ICS Church. Yes, 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 yes. Hallelujah. So before you take your seat, those people who are here on site, can you just give a heart to the person next to you? Greet them. Just smile with them. Even you have a face mask. Come on, come on. Let's just greet everyone. Let's just welcome everyone. To everyone who is watching online, we are so glad also that you can join us here on site. You can now sit down. Just relax. Have a good time in the presence of the Lord. I believe He will do something great today. And again, for those who are watching online, if you're new, first time watching here at ICS Church, we are so happy to see you there. to know that you are watching. You are one of the very important person today. Let us know. You can type N-E-W or new in the comment section so that one of our engagement team will connect with you. But if you're here on site for the first time, you're also one of the very important person today. We have something special for you, a gift later over our welcome area. One of our guests will welcome you today. So if you didn't yet share our stream, come on, let's share it. Let's invite some of our friends. And if you're here on site, you can also invite your friends next week to come and join us and experience this wonderful time of worship. Amen. Who are blessed today? Who are blessed today with our worship time? Amen, amen. And right now, let's continue to be blessed as we give our tithes and offering. You know, when we talk about giving, who believe among you here, among us, watching online, that you are blessed? If you believe that you are blessed, can you type, I am blessed. I am blessed. We are all blessed. And you know, as a follower of Christ, there's a reason of this blessing that the Lord has given to us. You know what? You know what's the reason of that blessing? There's a word from Paul, an apostle of Christ, teaching to those follower of Christ through Timothy, one of his disciples. It says in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 17 to 18, command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God. Okay? Who are rich? No one can say that they are rich. But every one of us, everything that we have, you know, this is all from our God. We have something to eat. We have something to drink. We have something to go home with our family. We are blessed. We are blessed. And all of this blessing that we have, it's not for our own pleasure. It's not just for our own. We just need to thank the Lord, for He is the one who given it to us. So, God providedly reached this with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds. So, all of our blessings is for us to share it to others. When is the last time that you share something to others? When is the last time that you bless others with the blessing that you have? That is the command of the Lord. That is one of His instruction for us as a follower. You know, your tithes and offering, all of this is a blessing for us here at ICS Church. I just want to give a shout out to all our media team because they're excellent service right now. You know, all of your blessings, what we are doing right now, all of that, to share the good news to other people is because of all of your giving. So may God continue to bless you. As God bless you more, you will bless others more. Can you say to your neighbor, bless others. Bless others. Okay, so right now I want to pray for every one of you. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the blessing that we have in you. Lord, all the blessing that we have and more blessing that we receive from you, Lord God, is an opportunity for us not to be arrogant with it, Lord, but to also take the opportunity to bless others because this is what you have commanded to us. Help us to be a channel of your blessing to others because this is your will. To all those people who are giving their tithes and offering, Lord, we thank you for these blessings, Lord God. We give it back to you, Lord, for the expansion of your kingdom. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. There are some ways how you can give your tithes and offering for those people who are here on site. There's an offering box out there. So you can give your tithes and offering. Right now, let's get ready as we receive the word of God to our senior pastor, Pastor Chad Visca.
All right. Come on. Thank you, Pastor Topher. Thank you, team. Thank you, Haynard. It is always, always a joy for us to have you with us at ICS Church. And, you know, there's something different when we come together and praise God. There's something different that happens. The atmosphere in the place, in the venue is different. So if you're one of those that we're missing right now in this room, we look forward to seeing you one of these Sundays in the days to come. Well, we've been doing a series this past week. Was our week of prayer. It's our mid-year prayer and fasting. So that was from Sunday last week all the way to Saturday yesterday. We finished our week of prayer and our theme that we've been talking about is fast forward. We said last week that sometimes when we're in a rush to accomplish things, to get somewhere, we need to actually pause, to step back. We want to slow down so that we can hear from God. We can submit our request to God so that His purposes will be fulfilled in our lives. So today we continue on with the second part of Fast Forward, and the title for today's message is Praise Forward. Praise Forward. How many of you guys remember the first time you rode an airplane? Or the first time You went on top of a high-rise building and looked outside. You guys still remember that? Do you remember the feeling when you looked outside the window and down below? And the people looked so small. The cars looked so small. And it seemed that all the problems that you had before you entered the elevator all of a sudden just started to fade away because everyone looked tiny and small. I remember the time when I climbed on top of a mountain. I was 16 years old, climbed on top of this mountain. We hiked together with family members. It took us about an hour and a half. And there wasn't anything special about the, you know, the journey up. It's rough road, it's rough tracks, it's dirt, it's stone, it's trees all around. There's hardly any view. But the moment you reach the top, it seemed like you suddenly landed on an island surrounded by a sea of clouds. And it seemed like, man, this is another planet, it's another place. And you forget about the worries. You forget about the problems that you face in life simply because of a new perspective. Yeah? It's like riding a plane. You forget about the hassles of waiting in the airport and all of, you know, the customs and going through all the checks. Because the moment the plane starts flying in the air and you look outside, it just feels like, man, it's just so peaceful here. There's no fights, there's no problems, and it shifts your mind. And in many ways, that's what happens when we pray and praise God. So many of us have already understood this. Prayer and praise has the power to change our circumstances for good. Did you know that? Prayer and praise has the power to change our circumstances for good. Now, if you've been a Christian for a while, you already know this. But if you're not a Christian, you might be saying, man, I don't understand all of that stuff. I don't even believe that stuff. But we're going to look at some thoughts today that will enable us to do that. In fact, you know, earlier this week, I posted a question on my page, on my profile, and some of you guys responded to that. So thank you for that response. You understand what praise is like. My question was, how does praise help you in everyday life, in everyday life? So, you know, it's always interesting to hear from friends from different places, the advantage of having social media. Ike, all the way from Atlanta, he said, it gives me the ability to fly above the things that the enemy throws at me and helps me to continue to stand on the promises of God because he who has promised is faithful. Amen. Amen. Praise enables him to do that. Auntie Emma, who's here right now, you posted. You said, it brings confidence in me that he is my refuge and strength. Amen. Right? With a little heart emoji right there. God assures us that he is with us through all these things. I mean, there's a whole bunch here. Kuya Abdiel said, you know, it's like the coffee that he has in the morning, but 100 times better than that because it helps him get through the day when he starts it off in praise. And Neil, who's in the room as well, Neil. So it is a little bit longer, but I want to read it right now. It says, praising God is my declaration and acknowledgement that he is sovereign and in control of everything in my life. It builds an intimate connection that draws me closer to him, and it assures me that I am secured no matter what the situation is, because his will is perfect and his love never fails. I mean, there's a whole other bunch that I could just read through there, but you guys obviously know that there is something that happens in praise, that praising God brings value to our life, that praising God can cause the situations around us to shift for the good. But don't take my word for it. If you're listening to this, if you're in the room, maybe you're not a Christian, or maybe you're like, yeah, I don't know about praise. You know, I mean, I'll be there on a Sunday, but I don't know about praising. Or if you're online, you may not even know Jesus. There's these two guys. Their names are Paul and Silas. These are first century followers of Jesus Christ, kind of faith in Christ. Paul was actually a former terrorist. He terrorized Christians. He persecuted Christians. He went around trying to find them, round them up, throw them in jail, and even witnessing the first martyrdom of a Christian. But God changed his life dramatically. He encountered Jesus one day, and his life made a 180-degree turn. He became an adamant, passionate follower of Jesus Christ, sharing about the good news wherever he went. So in one of these places, he brought along a new recruit named Silas. It tells us in the story in Acts chapter 16. This is found in the New Testament part of the Bible, written by Dr. Luke. The book of Acts, it tracks the beginnings of the church. And in Acts chapter 16, Dr. Luke writes, "Once when we were going to the place of prayer," Paul and Silas speaking here, "we were met by a female slave who had a spirit by which she predicted the future." And this female slave was going around announcing to the people, you know, these are the messengers of God. Listen to them. Now, if we would think to ourselves, that's pretty good. That's like free advertising, right? That's what companies do right now with social media. They put a product on and get people to share it. It's free advertising. You don't have to pay anybody. So you would think that this is actually a good thing. Hey, she's announcing to everybody who we are and preparing them to receive the good news that we're going to share. But they discerned in their spirit that this woman had a different kind of spirit. It wasn't a spirit that came from God. It was actually a demonic spirit. So after a couple of days, they stopped. And then they rebuked the devil, the demon that was in her, and she was released from the demon. So what that evil spirit actually enabled her to do was, you know, have the ability to predict its false predictions, the future. And what they didn't know, I'm sure Paul and Silas didn't know this, that this slave was actually owned by another. So she was employed by another. And apparently they were making money from her ability in predicting the future. So people were paying her and that money was going to her master. So they were not too happy about this situation and ended up bringing Paul and Silas to the courts in order, you know, to send them to jail. In verse 22, let's fast forward. As they accused them, here's what happens. In verse 20, these masters, these bosses, these employers, they brought them, Paul and Silas, before the magistrates and said, "These men are Jews and are throwing our city into an uproar by advocating customs unlawful for us Romans to accept or practice." The crowd joined in the attack against Paul and Silas, and the magistrates ordered them to be stripped and beaten with rods. After they had been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. When he received these orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. Now, man, what would you do if you were in their shoes? Here you are, following God, obeying God. Think to yourself, you know what? I'm doing God's work. That means He's with me. He's going to be blessing me. And I'm starting to see people come to Jesus. And, you know, this young woman has just been delivered from a demonic spirit. You'd be thinking, this is a time for rejoicing and celebrating. God is with us. I'm feeling good about myself. I'm feeling good about my work, my family, my life. And all of a sudden, here you are in front of the courts. And you're getting beaten up. And now you're in jail for something that you thought was actually not wrong at all. It was actually good what you did. And you know, that happens to us sometimes, right? I mean, we may not be in jail, but sometimes, man, I'm doing a good thing at work or with my family, but all of a sudden, all hell breaks loose. And it feels like, Lord, what's going on? What's going on? What's happening? What is our usual reaction when difficulties comes to us, right? We pause, we stop, and sometimes we scratch our head. Usually, naturally, a natural reaction would be to complain and to say, why is this happening? This shouldn't be happening to me. This isn't fair. I'm a good person. I'm a God follower. I just came from church, and now all of this is happening. God, why? Why are you allowing this to happen? And we probably may be filled with complaints. We may be filled with discouragement. We may be weighed down by the difficulties. I mean, these guys are doing a good thing and now they're suffering for it. They are being persecuted for it. It wasn't enough that they were beaten up. Now they've been thrown in jail. It wasn't enough that they're in jail. They're put in stocks. These are like wooden blocks that you put on people's feet so they cannot go anywhere. So you're sitting there, you're not able to do anything. The day before, you were preaching the good news. You were on the way to pray somewhere, and now you're sitting unable to do anything. The natural response would be to complain. Man, I've been stuck in the house for more than a year. I can't go anywhere. The natural response is to complain. Face shield on, face shield off. What is it? I don't really know. I mean, I keep getting mixed news. What am I supposed to do? The natural response is to complain. Once my business was doing well and now it's not. And the natural response is to be discouraged, to feel down, definitely not to praise God. But Paul and Silas were not like regular men. Remember, they had encountered Jesus. They had encountered God. And God had transformed their life from the inside out. When most likely before Christ, they probably would have fought these other people who were attempting to throw them in jail, maybe even start a fight against them. This time we don't see that. They didn't argue at the magistrate's court. They didn't fight physically with anyone. Remember, Paul was a former terrorist. He terrorized people. Now they were sitting in this place, and here in verse 25, here's what happens. They probably couldn't sleep. How many of you guys are like that? When you have a problem, you can't sleep, right? It says here in verse 25, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Wow. Wow. They were praying and singing to God. Well, obviously, there's nothing else to do. There's no internet. There's no Wi-Fi, right? What else am I going to do? I'm here. I'm sitting here. I might as well pray. I might as well start singing. And obviously, maybe the other prisoners didn't know how to sing. Nobody else was singing. They were singing. It says here that other prisoners were listening to them. So they were now entertaining the other prisoners. Maybe they were pretty good singers. I don't know. Verse 26 says, suddenly there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken. You know, that happens sometimes if you don't sing well. You sing so bad that people are like hitting the wall. Shut up! Be quiet! Right? The building is shaking. But that's not the case here. That's not the case here. It's not because they were not singing well. All right? We read further on. It says here, there was a violent earthquake. The foundations of the prison were shaken. At once, all the prison doors flew open and everyone's chains came loose. Now, this is pretty far out, Chad. I mean, this is kind of like, this is out there. You're telling me they're praying inside an inner cell with stocks on their feet, and for whatever reason, they just start praying and singing. You're telling me that because of their prayers and their singing, their praising, they cause an earthquake? They cause prison doors to open? They cause chains to be loosed? That's pretty powerful, singing and praying. But you see, it's not about their singing and praying. It's about the one who they were praying to and the one that they were praising in the midst of these circumstances. This is what caused this to happen. Many of us who are followers of Jesus already know this. Prayer and praise has the power to change our circumstances for good. A lot of times it seems that, you know what? This is a difficult situation. In my relationship, in my family, with my sickness, with my finances, it's difficult. It's tough. Some of us may even be getting persecuted because of our faith, just like Paul and Silas. And the natural response is to complain, is to say, God, why? I'm a good person. But instead of doing that, let's take the cue from Paul and Silas. The better response in the midst of difficulty, in the midst of suffering, whether it was brought upon ourselves through our own ability or outside of us, just like what happened here, it's external circumstances that brought this suffering and pain to them. Instead of complaining, I'm just gonna pray. That's what we did this week. We said it's important to pause and pray. There are things that we want to accomplish. There are goals that we have set for ourselves. before we get going through our own strength, we've got to pause and pray so that we can submit it to God and tell God our concerns. Many of us at ICS Church did that this past week, from Monday all the way to Saturday. Yesterday, we did that. We prayed. In fact, we weren't satisfied just with the noontime prayer. We added a Friday night to pray as well, because we know that prayer and praise shifts the atmosphere. We know that when we pause, pray, and praise, God invades our circumstances. And when He does that, things get better, just like what happened to Paul and Silas. So don't take my word for it. Here are a couple of tips that we learned from their experience. Four things that we learned from these guys about the power and the importance of prayer and praise. First of all, prayer and praise shifts our attention from ourselves to God. If we're all about me and all about my problem, when that problem comes, even if it's not brought about by my decision, but by external forces, external circumstances, and other people that I don't have any issue with, but they're the ones that bring it up against me, we have to be quick to say, Lord God, okay, this is beyond me. This is outside of my control. When we pray, submitting to God our cares, and praise, declaring who God is. That's what praising is. We're declaring who God is, who He is, as the scripture declares who God is. Our attention begins to be lifted up. Excuse me, throat is getting dry. That's what happens when you speak excitedly. When we pray and praise, we stop thinking about our circumstances and we go to somebody who can actually do something about it. When we pray and praise, we say, God, here are my circumstances. I'm lifting them up to you. You know what happens when you begin to do that? Your physical posture begins to change. See, when we have our problems, a lot of times, what happens to our physical posture? Our shoulders are hunched, our head is bowed, we're walking slower than we used to, and people can tell. And they say, hey, what's going on? Do you have a problem? Even if we don't say anything. Why? Because our physical posture communicates that. But the moment we decide, you know what, I'm going to pray and praise God. I'm going to pray, lift up my concerns to Him, and praise Him, declare who He is over my circumstances. Our physical posture shifts. We begin to lift up our eyes to the heavens. Why? Because God is the one that we're looking to. We begin to call upon His name and address His name. And He comes into our situation. Instead of poor me, we start to say, praise God. Instead of putting our faith and trust in me, we start to put our faith and trust in God. Excuse me. Hindi po yung COVID. Dry throat lang po. All right. This changes our attitudes from complaining to praising. And it helps change our perspective from the difficulties that we are facing over to God. Secondly, prayer and praise shifts the battle from the natural to the supernatural. Because as followers of Jesus, we know that the circumstances surrounding us, whether it's material or it's in relationships, there is always a spirituality behind it. There is always a spirit behind it, whether it is God's spirit or an evil spirit that's been sent by the devil, that is what is present. Paul and Silas understood this. So when this slave girl who had the ability to predict the future, they discerned was actually not from God, they stopped, cast it out, and set her free from that demonic spirit. It allows us to shift our situations around. When we try to battle our circumstances through our natural abilities, it can get overwhelming. When we look at our situation and we say, you know what, I'm going to try to do this through my own strength. I'm going to try to resolve my problem through my own strength. Doesn't it become wearying? At some point after you have exhausted all of your abilities, all of your efforts, don't you feel tired? It's wearying. It's tiring. But when we turn our attention to God, when we shift our focus on God and invite Him instead to come into the circumstance and declare Him over the situation, He is already fighting the battle that He's already won. When we acknowledge Him, God is the one that fights the battle for us. Many times, if we read in the scriptures in the Old Testament, whenever the nation of Israel were commanded to invade a new territory, who does God send ahead? It's not the mightiest warriors. It's not the strongest men. A lot of times, you know who God puts in the front? It's the worshipers. It's the tribe of Levi. And they're not trained for warfare. They're trained to worship and praise God. Why? Because God was wanting to show to Israel and to the surrounding pagan nations that it wasn't through their own physical strength and might and wisdom that these wars were being won. It was because God was with them. And so when we elevate our situation to God through prayer and praise, we are in fact saying, Lord God, I'm putting my trust in You. I'm trusting that You will fight the battle because You've already won it for me. And all I need to do is to walk on that path that You have already won. Thirdly, prayer and praise brings breakthroughs in impossible situations. There are circumstances that we will encounter that seems impossible, that we will not overcome through our own strength, through our own ability. And no matter how smart we are, no matter how much money we have, it won't be enough. And it will literally be impossible. It'll be impossible. But when we invite God to come into the circumstance and begin to declare Him over the situation, He Himself will come and begin to loosen the chains. That's exactly what happened to Paul and Silas. This was an impossible situation. First of all, they had been severely physically beaten. Right? They were stripped naked and beaten with rods, thrown into the inner cell. Right? So you got your cell here. This is like first star, second star, third star. That was like a five-star cell because it's all the way inside with no windows and no way to get out. That's where they were. And it's not enough that you're in the inner cell. We're going to put you in stocks just to be sure. This is an impossible situation. You're in stocks. You're in the inner cell. The doors are locked. But as we invite God in prayer, as we declare Him over our circumstances, and they're beginning to sing here. I don't know what they were singing, right? You have no rival. You have no equal. I don't know. They may have been singing that song. I don't know. But as they're seeing what happens, they're starting to feel the earth move. The ground is trembling. The ground is shaking. And all of a sudden, because of the shaking and the earthquake, the doors fly open. Now, it makes sense for the doors to fly open, but how do the chains get loose? What does that have to do with earthquakes? Nothing. Because it was God's power that invaded that prison cell. Their chains are loosed, and what was impossible all of a sudden is now possible. You may be facing circumstances right now in terms of your sickness that are impossible, and maybe the doctors have already said, you know what, yeah, it is impossible. But you know what, we serve a God of possibilities. You may be facing circumstances right now where it says, you know, you lack stuff, you don't have enough, and you're thinking, yes, I don't know how long I'm gonna last. But you know what? Jehovah, His other name is Jireh. He is the God who provides. We can rely on Him. We can trust in Him because He's a God of possibilities. You have a concern, you have a need, God has a name and an answer for it. This is how good and how amazing this God is. But if we have not taken time to pause, pray, and praise Him in the middle of our circumstances, we will not have an opportunity to experience that in our own life. We will continue to walk around with our heads bowed, our shoulders hunched, and people will wonder, I thought you were a Christian. Why are you sad all the time? Well, maybe it's because we haven't paused, prayed, and praised yet. Come on. See, that's the beauty about praising God, is it's not about us. It's not about my feeling. It's me declaring who God says he is. That's what praising is. It's never determined by our circumstances, but is always anchored in the truth of who God is. And as Paul and Silas paused, they had no choice. They were in prison. They had to pause. They prayed. They submitted their concerns to God. And that wasn't enough, because sometimes that's what we do. Poor me, here's my situation. Lord, have mercy. And it's about me. They also praised God. This is who you are. This is who you are. And I don't know about you, when you begin to praise God, when I begin to praise God, I start to feel encouraged. wait a minute, I'm not even encouraging myself. That's right. When you start to praise God, his reality, his tangible presence, his spirit invades the room. It invades the space. Wasn't he there before? He's been there all the time. He's never left. But because we've never paused and acknowledged him and praised him in the midst of our circumstances, we have not felt his touch. And he's saying, if you would just pause and stop complaining and stop looking at how big your problem is and looking at how big I am, how big your God is, then you would know, you would experience, you would be assured of my presence. And it is in that moment that God begins to shift. He begins with us. He shifts our perspective. He shifts our hearts. He elevates our faith to go a step higher and deeper in him. And physically, tangibly, there is a physical manifestation of a change that happens, beginning with us and rippling to others. That's what happened here. You see, the chains that were loose were not just theirs. The doors that flew open were not just their prison doors. Read it for yourself. Acts chapter 16. It says, all the doors in the prison flew open. All the chains of the prisoners were loosed. When we praise and pray to God, he doesn't just answer our prayer. He multiplies that blessing to others. He touches us. He transforms us. He blesses us, and it overflows out of our lives, spilling over to those around us. This freedom that they were enjoying right now were not just theirs, even though these other people were not praising God. It says that they were just listening to them. Because of what they heard, God came into their situation. I'm sure that some of them were starting to put their faith, man, if that's really true, what they are praying, what they are singing and praising about, I'm going to trust in that God too, for my freedom, for my deliverance, for my situation, for him to come and set me free. Prayer and praise releases blessings to others. It has multiplied to others. So in these circumstances, we see a shift taking place in their life that has multiplied blessings. Have you done that lately? Have you done that lately? It might be the reason why you're feeling sad today. I mean, you've been singing about God, but if you have not chosen to participate, you say, Chad, I don't really sing. I can't carry a tune. See, praising is not just about singing. It's about declaring who he is. In the English word, we only have one word for praise. But in the Hebrew, there are three. There's yada, which is praise and thanksgiving. There is melzar, which is praising God. In singing, right? And praising God because of our circumstances through the situation that we're in. Doesn't have to always mean that you have to sing, but it's taking the Psalms and reading through it and declaring who he is in our circumstances. When we pray, a lot of times it's centered on us. When we praise, the focus is elevated to God and who he is. Paul and Silas didn't just pray and submit their situation to God. They praised him as well. They praised him as well. Some of us right now who are going through a difficult health situation, we just need to praise God through it. Some of us who are facing difficulties in our relationships, God is just asking you and reminding you, come on, I've already heard your prayer. Now I need you to praise through it. I need for you to start declaring me through that work, through that relationship, through that marriage, no, through that job, through that difficult circumstance. Just praise me through it. Why? Because when you do, your perspective will change. When you do, I will come in and assure you of my peace, of my comfort, of my provision, of my guidance. I will allow my presence to invade your space. And when that happens, when we're filled up to overflowing, it spills over and out to other people. Do you see people after watching a really good movie? What do? The moment they go out of the movie, what do? They tweet about it, they put it on social media, they tell other people, hey, you should watch this movie. Hey, you should listen to this band I just discovered. They're beaming, their smiles are all out. Why? Because they're excited, they want to share what they've experienced. This is so much better than that. When God comes in, when we pray and praise Him, it's a feeling that is not fleeting. It is something that will last forever. Why? Because that's His promise for us. I will not leave you. I will not forsake you. When God gives a promise, He fulfills it. It is not temporary. It is not circumstantial. You don't only get to experience the peace and the joy that God gives when you come into this physical location. Don't get me wrong. I love Sundays and I love that we get together, as you do as well. I love getting with circle groups, with a small group of people, and just sharing wins and sharing what God is doing in our lives and celebrating together. But even when you're alone, you need to know that right there in your room, when you walk out of this space, God is gone before you and He is with you. When Paul and Silas were in court, God was there. Before they ever walked in to that prison room, that inner cell, God's Spirit was already there. But the difference was, they chose to acknowledge Him. There were other prisoners that they were there as well, but none of them knew Jesus. None of them knew God the way that Paul and Silas knew God. And if we would just come to a point in our life where we would say, Lord God, yes, times are difficult, finances are limited, I'm sick, but regardless of all of these situations, Lord God, You are still worthy of praise. I still choose to lift You up. I still choose to magnify Your name despite of all of these challenges. I love the stories that we've heard here at church about how some of you, God has seen you through some of the toughest situations. You know, Christian is in the room today. We're so glad that he's in the room with us. But he shared a couple of weeks ago, this family, they're so careful, right? Take every precaution not to get infected. But for whatever reason, that COVID found its way in the home. And what's ironic is that Christian is the only one who got it. His wife was a doctor who goes to the clinics and to the hospitals. Didn't get it. The children didn't get it. And you know, sometimes we wonder, Lord, why? I mean, we've taken precautions. He's part of our prayer team, is faithful, loves his wife, loves his children, serves the church. And that could cause us to ask God, why? But you would hear in his testimony that despite all those things, it took time to pause, to spend time in God's presence. And God shifted these questions and elevated it to a place where he knew God has a greater purpose beyond what we know. I'm sure Paul and Silas had no idea that God was about to break every prison door when they walked in there. That wasn't the plan. They didn't know that. I mean, for all they knew, the next thing was they were probably going to die. And so they did what they said it normally did. Remember, that's what they normally did. They were on the way to prayer. This was something that commonly was done. The place was different. The situation was different. You know what didn't change? Their faith in God. See, if God leads you to pray and praise, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter where you are, whether you're in a prison cell or you're outside in freedom, whether you're in a hospital room or in a mall, whether you're in the mountaintop or the valley, God still is worthy to be praised and to be honored. And when we pause, pray, and praise Him, He will come and shift our circumstances. What seems to be negative, what seems to be bad, He will turn for good as we take time to do that. I want to encourage you today to do that with whatever it is you're facing. You may be listening to this. You may be here in this room and you don't know Jesus. You're saying, I don't even know this Jesus. I don't even know how to pray. I don't even know how to praise. I mean, what are you talking about? Chad, I don't even know how to do any of those things that you have been talking about. Well, the beauty about that is God came to earth. He became man. Jesus, to show to us how much He loves us, to show to us how much He cares for us. And as we put our faith and trust in Him today, we can actually experience Him in our own life, leading us. And if you don't know how to praise, it's just declaring who God is. The best way to do that is to get a Bible. You can do that online. Open to the book of Psalms and look at these Psalms that declare who He is. One of the Psalms that I really love is Psalm 113. And Psalm 113 says, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, you His servants. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is exalted over all the nations, the glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord? Our God, the one who sits enthroned on high, who stoops down to look on the heavens and the earth. He raises the poor from the dust and lifts the needy from the ash heap. He sets them with the princes of His people. He settles the childless woman in her home as a happy mother of children. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. The psalmist says, from the rising of the sun to its setting. That means the entire day, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, regardless of the circumstances in the situation, God is worthy to be praised. And when we choose to praise Him, when we choose to lift up His name in the midst of difficulty, in the midst of trial, yes, on the mountain and down in the valley, His presence will invade an impossible situation, shift it around, and turn it for good, for your benefit, for His glory, so that others would know that there is a God who loves them. And you need to do that today. The beauty about the ending of the story, the jailer who was guarding Paul and Silas, he's about to commit suicide because he said, man, the prison doors are open. The prisoners have escaped. Paul and Silas speaks up and says, hey, wait, we are still here. Do not worry. They share Jesus to him. The jailer becomes a follower of Jesus. The jailer brings them to his house. They declare the good news. The jailer's entire household becomes a follower of Jesus. Why? Because when God blesses, He multiplies that beyond what we could ask or even think of. And today, that is what God wants to do in your life, in your family, in your work, in your circumstances, through sickness, through difficulty. God is a God of breakthrough, and you need to trust in Him today. So come on, in this room, would you stand together with me? In your homes where you're watching, would you stand to your feet? There's a song that we sung earlier. We're gonna sing it again. I want you to sing that with all your heart. Declare it. He has no rival. He has no equal. There is no other God that is deserving praise and worship. And we want to lift Him up today. Come on, praise Him in the midst of your circumstances.
Come on, let's lift up our voice in worship.
Yours is the King.
right now, begin to declare God as your healer. If you're sick in body, He is Jehovah Rophe, the God who heals. If you are in need of provision, He is Jehovah Jireh, the God who provides. If you're in need of righteousness, He is Jehovah Makadesh, who is your righteousness. He is all your sufficiency. He is everything that you need. Call upon His name. Declare Him as Lord over your life, over your family, over your circumstances. Yes, Lord, we lift you up, Jesus. We lift you up, Jesus. We praise your name over every and all circumstances, despite what we're facing, despite, Lord God, what we're going through. You remain worthy of glory. You remain worthy of honor, Lord God. We choose today to worship you on the mountaintop. We will choose to continue to worship you and praise you, even in the valley and everywhere in between, Lord God. We lift you up today. We magnify your name. Father, let there be a breakthrough right now in Jesus' name. Let their Lord God, provision be released in Jesus' name. Lord, we command the blessing to come in Jesus' name. For jobs to open up, for businesses, Lord God, to be blessed. Father, we command cancer to be released in Jesus' name. We command every infirmity to be released, Lord God, and to be alleviated in Jesus' name. Those who are infected with COVID-19, Father, we take authority in the matchless name of Jesus Christ. And we command the sickness, Lord God, to be removed in Jesus' name. Come on, mention to the Lord what that sickness is, what that difficulty is, and command it in the name of Jesus to be released right now. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You know, we're enjoying this time together today as a church, but there may be some of you right now who don't know Jesus. And like what I said earlier, He wants you to experience His blessing. He wants you to experience joy. He wants you to experience provision that only He can give. And it can begin today. Would you come to Him right now in prayer? All that you need to do is to trust in Him. To say, Lord God, I believe in you. I trust in you. After you pray with me, making it your own prayer, it can begin right now. Lord Jesus, thank you for loving me. Thank you for living a perfect, sinless life for me. Thank you for being my righteousness all the way to the cross. That through your death and ultimately on your resurrection, Lord, you restored a way back to my Heavenly Father. And so it is in you that I put my trust in today. Forgive me of all my sin and everything that stands between me and my Heavenly Father. I ask you to come and rule in my life. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. I choose to follow you beginning today. I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Hey, we rejoice with you. All of heaven is rejoicing with you. We thank you for making that choice today. And our desire here is to help you grow in your walk with the Lord. So if you made that decision, would you type in the comment, I chose to follow Jesus. Or if you're here in this room and you made that choice today, let us know. Talk to any of our pastors. We would love to encourage you to grow in your walk with the Lord. Come on, let's lift our voices. Let's give God praise.
We sing holy.
presence. We celebrate in your presence. Thank you, Lord. Amen. So, Isis Robley, thank you. And see you next Sunday. Have a blessed week ahead. Always remember, brace forward.
Amen. Bye. God bless you. Bye-bye.